Hello fellow chess players and welcome in today's video where we are reviewing the match played between Herman Pilnik and Bobby James Fischer. This game was played in 1959 in Mar del Plata, it's a town in Argentina, and this was a high-tier tournament. There were a lot of strong grandmasters from the time, as Pilnik, Najdorf, Ivkov, Pac-Man, and yeah, Fischer himself of course. So a lot of strong and good players from the time. And this is a nice game won by Bobby Fischer, and let's see how he did it. Herman Pilnik has the black the white pieces, and he opens with e4, and Fischer replies with c5. The Sicilian defense, knight f3, d6, d4, going for the open Sicilian. C captures on d4, knight captures, knight to f6, knight to c3, and now a6, the Najdorf variation, and now bishop to e2, the Opeczenski variation. E5, kicking away the knight, knight to b3, now bishop to e7, and both sides prepare to castle, so kingside castle, and now bishop to e3, bishop to e6, and now f3. By Herman Pilnik. In the time this game was played, this was a very popular opening. The plan for White was to place the queen on e1, then place it on g3, h4, and placing your bishop on h6, and then attacking the black king this way. But with the comest of modern engines, it is now known that this system for White doesn't give any advantage, because you don't avoid, or you don't give black any problems developing pieces, and you don't avoid him expanding his queenside attack. So it's not not a good system for white, and nowadays it's not popular anymore. But okay, f3, queen to c7, queen to e1, knight b to d7, and now rook to d1. B5, going for the queenside attack, and now rook to d2, somewhat an rare move, I would say an awkward move, because I don't see a direct purpose in this move, but okay. Now knight to b6, and I already spoiled it, but here the best move for white is to pick off the black knight. Why is this the best move? Because I will explain you in a few moves. Here, Pilnik made his first real mistake in the game. He played queen to f2. Why is this a mistake? Because now you allow Bobby to play knight to c4. What's the problem with knight to c4? This comes with an attack on the rook and on the pawn. So you have to snatch it off. And now comes b captures on c3. Now the knight is under attack, and you have to, of course, you have to move the knight. The knight has two possible squares to go. It can go to a1 or c1, but neither of these squares are a good square for the knight. So let's see what happens if the knight goes to a1. Now black can continue the attack with rook a to b8. And after rook to b1, defending this pawn, black will just do a mini rook lift, place his rook here on b8, and will have a lot of pressure on the b2 pawn. So this is not a pleasant position to play for white. So instead of knight to a1, you can also try to go to c1, but now you're even blocking your rook to come towards the b1 square to help defend the b2 square. So now the same ID applies for black, and that is rook a to b8. And now if you let's say play knight to a4 to defend the b2 pawn, now black can just play c3. This comes with a double attack on the pawn and on the rook, so you have to trade it. So b captures on c3. But now just queen to c6, attacking the knight. Knight on knight b6. There it is defended by the bishop and also by the queen, so it is defended two times. But now just bishop to d8, and white has to play something now because it is attacked three times, like knight to d5. But now after capture, capture, and capture, black is up pawn and white has this doubled pawns here. This is, yeah, a very annoying position for white. So that is the reason why knight to c1 isn't a good alternative either. So what white also can try is to play bishop to b6. This looks a very strong move, and maybe it's even the best move. And after queen to c8, yeah, your queen is under attack, you have to move it. Now you can play knight to a5. There it is, defended and guarded by the bishop. But now just knight to d7, and after, let's say, knight to d5, and after some trades, yeah, the bishop is under attack two times, only defended once, so it has to move. Only good square available for the bishop is bishop to e3, and now black can just capture the pawn on b2, and this knight is placed awkwardly, so yeah, black is definitely better here. So knight to c4, definitely the strongest move in the position for black, but for some reason, yeah, Bobby Fischer didn't play knight to c4. He played rook a to b8. After the game, he said, "I know that knight to c4 was the strongest move, but I figured if white wanted to capture my knight, he would have done it in this position here." So after queen to f2, he thought, yeah, he wants to keep his bishop, and he doesn't want to yeah, give up his bishop for my knight. And now I have the opportunity to go to either a4 or c4 later in the game when I want. But at this time, Spilnik has figured out that he made a mistake by not capturing the knight, so he does it now. So bishop captures on b6, and now rook captures on b6. Okay, now knight to d5, yeah, forking the queen and the rook. So you have to solve this. Knight captures on d5, e captures on d5, and now bishop to d7. Now white has a good pushed pawn, which is defended by the rook. Okay, so he tries to, he continues his attack with f4, trying to bust open the f-file and have some pressure on, yeah, on the king. In this position, a logical move for black would have been f5, but now you really weaken the e6 square. So yeah, Fischer didn't want to allow this. So that is why bishop to f6 is played. And now c3, just improving your pawn structure. Rook back to b8, because it was under attack by the queen, and if at some point you want to move your queen here, or I don't know where, but yeah, then you don't have to keep in mind that your queen is the piece that is guarding your rook, so now your queen is free to move wherever she wants. So f captures on e5, bishop captures on e5. You do not recapture with this pawn here, because now d6 gives white really the initiative. So that's why bishop on e5 is played, and now knight to d4, just improving the position of the knight. Now g6 and a3 by white. Why a3? Because black is definitely planning to play a5 and then to push b4. And now after playing a3, white really has a firm grip on the b4 square. So a3, a5, and now king to h1. Because, yeah, your king and your queen, they were on the same diagonal, a dark diagonal. You don't have a dark squared bishop anymore. Black has a dark squared bishop, so it can be dangerous in the future, so just a prophylactic king move. And now Fischer pushes b4. And now we have c captures on b4. You don't capture with the a pawn. Why not? Well, because after a captures on b4 and c4, now b3 by black, and now it is black who keeps who keeps the initiative. So that is why you captured c pawn. Black recaptures, and now you don't recapture immediately because then after rook captures, black will have a lot of pressure on the b2 pawn. The bishop is x-raying this pawn, so yeah, that's not the best move. So first rook to c2, attacking the queen. Queen has to move. Queen goes to b6, and now knight to c6. Definitely a strong square for the knight. You're attacking the strong dark squared bishop, so yeah, that's a good move. And now Fischer continued the game with b captures on a3. Now I recommend you to consider this position for for a few seconds and try to figure out if white can take the rook on b8. Kenny, no, he can't, because let's see what happens if he does. After knight captures on b8, black can capture the queen here. You have to recapture, otherwise, yeah, you just lost your queen. So now a2 by black, threatening to promote. White has to defend, so rook to f1. And now bishop to to f5, attacking the rook. Rook goes back to c1, and now rook captures on b8. And if you take a look at this position, yeah, white is up material, but black has a very strong pushed pawn. They always say a pawn on the seventh or the second rank, depends on which color you play. It's worth the exact same points as a rook is worth. So this is worth five points now, and yeah, white will have to give up material to avoid black from promoting this pawn. So let's say bishop to c4 to attack the pawn. Now just rook captures on b2, protecting it and capturing a pawn. And now after rook to a1 with double attack on the pawn now, try, if you, I don't know if you can see it, but it's really a funny move from black. He can play bishop to b1, and now if the rook moves either here or here, yeah, your rook is then white's rook is under attack and he will lose it, or you have to give up the exchange. And yeah, this position is definitely winning for black. So yeah, that's the reason why you don't capture the rook here on b8. So the best move for white is to capture the queen. Rook recaptures, and now b captures on a3. And now rook to a8 attacking. And now Spilnik decided to to take off the to capture the dark squared bishop by capturing bishop to e5, and now d captures on e5. If you analyze this game with an engine, the engine will agree and say that this is a good move, but now you have given black a passed pawn, which is annoying to defend against. So yeah, there was a better move in this position, and the move was rook to a2, defending the pawn. And let's say after rook to b2 and some trades here, the pawn is attacked twice, you cannot defend it, but you still have this move, bishop to b5. And this is, yeah, a beautiful move, I think, because, yeah, you lose the pawn. But now you set up this trap by playing knight to e7, a discovery check, so you will pick off the bishop the next move. Black can defend by playing king to f8, so if white captured the bishop, he can just recapture and material will be equal. Yeah, black will be a pawn up, but what is called a desperado attack, knight to g6 with check, so black has to recapture, and now you capture the bishop, and this is an equal position. Yeah, a player like Spilnik, he should be able to draw this against Fischer. Maybe black is a little bit better, but it is not so simple Yeah, to win this game for black. So yeah, bishop to b5, really a good move. But okay, rook to a2 isn't played in this position. Yeah, Spilnicki captured the bishop, Fischer recaptured, and now rook to c3. Rook to c7 doesn't really do much. Now you're x-raying this pawn here, and it's also attacked by the rook on f1. But black can just defend by playing rook to d6. And now you can even try to go for this attack, maybe go for a perpetual check. If you play bishop to b5, try to deflect the bishop from blocking this line. But this move is refuted by rook to c8. Because now if rook captures, you recapture here, so you don't lose material and you're up a bishop. And even if you try to find a perpetual check, there is no perpetual check in the position because black can just escape. He can just walk towards his rooks and he will be guarded enough. So let's say here now black runs away to d8 and the black king is safe and white is losing here because he's down a full bishop. So that is why rook to c3 is played and now Fischer played rook to b2, putting his rook on a very active square, attacking the bishop, always having the possibility to go to a2. Placing your rook behind a passed pawn, that is a place where a rook should be. But now, rook to c7 is possible because the rook cannot longer come to d6. And this also comes with an attack on the bishop, and the same idea still applies here. So Fischer find a good idea to avoid Spilnik plan, and he plays bishop to f5. Now you block the line from the f1 rook, so he doesn't any longer attack the f7 pawn. And now Spilnik tries to deflect away the bishop, and he plays g4. Now bishop to e5, e4 with check, and Spilnik blocks with his bishop, and he plays bishop to f3. Now bishop to d3, attacking the rook, and rook. Now, first of all, d6. And now I recommend you to pause the video here and try to figure out if black can capture the rook and still keep the advantage, or that this loses the game or gives black a disadvantage. If you try to do so, capturing the rook gives black a disadvantage. Because now white can capture black's rook. And now, for example, let's say rook to d2, putting your rook behind the passed pawn. And now just pawn to d7. Now it's attacked by the rook. And on the next move, now you're threatening to play rook to c8. This comes with check, and then you can promote. So, what happens if black tries to avoid this and places its king on g7. Now you just have bishop to c6, and the same idea applies. You will play rook to c8, and then you will promote on the next move. So black has to give up material to keep this position. So capturing the rook on a8 is on f1 is not the best move. So that is why Bobby Fischer played rook to d8 and now rook to e1. Yeah. Replacing your rook because it was under attack. So now rook captures on d6 is played by Bobby Fischer, but actually in this position there was a much stronger move, and the move was actually found by Miguel Najdorf. After the game, he said, "Hey, Bobby, you could have played this move, and I'm going to let you find it yourself." Okay, if you found it, the move that Najdorf recommended, and it's also the absolute strongest move, is e4. What happens after e4 at At first it looks like you're just giving up a pawn because it is attacked two times and only defended once, but after bishop captures, black can play rook to b1. And now white will lose material because if rook captures, now bishop captures with check. King has to move and you you pick up the rook and you're up a bishop. E4 definitely the strongest move, but Bobby Fischer missed it and he played rook to captures d6. Rook captures e5 and now rook to f6 attacking the bishop. And now Spilnik defends and places his rook on e3. Attacking Black's white squared bishop and also defending his bishop. But now Fischer finds a nice tactic to finish the game. And for the last time, I recommend you to pause the video and find it yourself. The move that Fischer played, it is actually an exchange sacrifice, is a rook captures on f3. Let's see what happens after rook captures on f3. Now bishop to e4, and now the rook is pinned to the king, and the king can't come anywhere near the rook because it is held off from the black rook here on b2. So now Spilnik played rook captures on f7, defending his rook, but now just rook to f2 by black, and Spilnik tried this check. Now king to g7, and it was in this position on move 40 that Herman Spilnik resigned the game. Why did he resign? Well, he can't do anything anymore. He can try to attack the bishop and deflect it away, but now just bishop to b7. You cannot attack it anymore. No, bishop to b7 would be a mistake. Bishop to a8. You cannot attack it anymore. And now you have to play something, let's say rook here. You can just capture. The white king is in a discovery attack, so you have to recapture. Now after capture, this comes with check, and then you also grab this pawn here, and now black is just up a full bishop, and the position is lost for white. So yeah, and a great victory by Bobby Fischer, the third victory of the third video we are covering. There will be coming more soon. Thank you for sticking with me until the end of this video. I really hope you learned something from this game, and I'll see you next time.